I think we're ready to get started. Thank you all for coming this morning. I'm Dan Bob, and I am a senior fellow and director of programs at the Sasakawa USA Foundation. And we are we're delighted to be sponsoring our first ever program for the Cherry Blossom Festival, which I also understand is the first time that the festival itself has had a policy-oriented program. And for those of you unfamiliar with us at Sasakawa USA, I just wanted to mention we are an American 501c3 nonprofit, and our focus is on research, analysis, and better understanding of U.S.-Japan relations in bilateral, regional, and global context. This, of course, is a very important year in U.S.-Japan relations because it is the 70th anniversary since the end of the war. And it also is really a dynamic period in U.S.-Japan relations, coming after a couple decades in which attention toward Japan has been, over the past couple of decades, has been less than it was in previous years. I think that dynamism largely reflects the efforts both on an economic side and on the security side by Prime Minister Abe over the past 2 years. He's taken a number of important steps and on the economic side, an array of policies that have come to be known as Abenomics. He's also brought Japan into the Trans-Pacific Partnership negotiations, and it seems at this point that we're relatively close to a bilateral U.S. agreement, which really is the key hurdle that we face before we finalize the agreement amongst all 12 countries. The Prime Minister has also created a new National Security Council. He initiated the first new national security strategy in many decades, led his cabinet to reinterpret the Constitution to permit the exercise of collective self-defense, and is working right now with the U.S. on finalizing the first new bilateral defense guidelines in 18 years. And with all these developments, we at Sasakawa USA thought it would really be useful to sort of take a step back and examine some of the basics of the relationship. So we commissioned two important research projects, and the results of that are what we'll be featuring at today's discussions. The first of these is a Pew Research poll on American attitudes towards Japan, and as well as vice versa, Japanese attitudes towards the United States. And all of you, I believe, have received copies of that report. The second is an East-West Center analysis of the role Japan plays across a variety of sectors in the United States, from jobs created by Japanese companies to Japanese students studying in the U.S., sister city relationships, and these are all at a national, state, as well as congressional district level, and that's a web-based product that you'll all should have access to as of today. So today we're going to begin with presentations by Bruce Stokes of Pew and Satu LeMay of East-West Center on their findings from their respective projects. Then we'll get an assessment of the findings by Ambassador Tom Schieffer and Hiroyuki Akita of Nikkei. And then we'll close out the program with remarks from our chairman and CEO at Sasakawa USA, Admiral Dennis Blair. So I'm going to just quickly introduce all of our participants, and then we'll get right to things. First speaker will be Bruce Stokes, who is the director of global economic attitudes at the Pew Research Center's Global Attitudes Project, and there he assesses public and expert views on economic conditions, values, and policies. He's also a former international economics correspondent for many years at National Journal, was a senior fellow at German Marshall Fund, and a former senior fellow also at the Council on Foreign Relations. Dr. Satu LeMay is director of the East-West Center in Washington, where he's been for the past 8 years. He also serves concurrently as a senior advisor to the CNA Corporation, which is a nonprofit research and analysis organization in Alexandria. And he is the creator of the initiative called Asia Matters for America, which this Japan portion is part of. And he's also a founding editor of the Asia Pacific Bulletin series, editor of the Global Asia Journal, and on the advisory council of the Journal of Contemporary Southeast Asia. Previously, he served at the Institute for Defense Analyses, as well as the Asia Pacific Center for Security Studies. Ambassador Tom Schieffer is founder and principal of Envoy International, a consulting firm that provides a whole range of services to international companies. And of course, he served as ambassador to Japan from 2005 to 2009 and was involved in negotiating a major reorganization of U.S.-Japan reliance. And in 2009, he received the Distinguished Public Service Award, which is Defense Department's highest civilian award and recognition of that work on the alliance. He's also served previously as U.S. ambassador to Australia, and before his diplomatic service was an investor in the partnership that bought the Texas Rangers Baseball Club, and he served there for 8 years as its president. He's had a long involvement in Texas politics, having been elected to the Texas House of Representatives for 3 times. We also have Mr. Akita, Hiroyuki Akita, who is with the Nikkei Shimbun as editorial and senior staff writer. He started there in 1987, writing in the marketing news and international news departments, but he has served in far afield as Beijing Bureau. He was also the staff writer in the political news department, senior correspondent here in Washington, D.C., and staff writer, deputy editor of the political news department. So we have a really terrific group of people with us today to talk about the results of the surveys and poll, and we have a great couple of people to assess what this all means. So let me turn things now to our first speaker, Bruce Stokes. Bruce.
Thank you, Dan. It's a real pleasure and a privilege to be here, and I want to take this opportunity to thank the Sasakawa Peace Foundation USA for their support for this survey. We could not have done it without them, and we really do appreciate this partnership where we were able to do this kind of survey both in Japan and in the United States. As Dan said, it's a very propitious time to conduct this kind of public opinion research. Ambassador Schieffer's, one of his predecessors, Mike Mansfield, who was the U.S. ambassador to Tokyo in the 1980s, once called the U.S.-Japan relationship the single most important relationship bar none, bilateral relationship bar none that the United States had. And we think the bar none relationship has a number of issues and challenges and opportunities ahead of it at this juncture. TPP, the defense guidelines, the U.S. pivot to Asia. And so we thought it was a very good, and the 70th anniversary of the end of World War II, and this was a good time to actually try to take the pulse of both the American and the Japanese people and get a sense of how they're feeling about each other, about their relationship, and about the challenges they share ahead. Just to give you briefly a background on the Pew Research Center, we are a nonpartisan, non-advocacy fact tank in Washington. We do largely public opinion survey research, also social and demographic research. We do not take positions on issues, but we attempt to inform the public debate about using public opinion now from 82 countries around the world, going back to 2002. This survey in particular was done by telephone in the U.S. and in Japan, 1,000 respondents in each country, as you can see, done in mid-February or early February in Japan. For those of you who care about these things, it was both landlines and cell phones, and the survey represents the demographic profile of both countries. So, to give you an example, if 51% of the population is female, then 51% of the survey is female, et cetera, et cetera. So, and the margin of error is about 3.5%, which is typical of surveys of this nature. Just to give you an overview, what we found, we asked people in Japan if they trusted the United States. We asked people in the United States if they trusted Japan. 2/3 of Americans trust Japan, either a great deal or a fair amount, and 3/4 of Japanese trust the United States. I would say this is a fairly good endorsement of the relationship. Neither one of us trust China, however. We trust China a little bit more than the Japanese do, but still it's not a great degree of trust in America either. But we do differ on whether Japan should play a greater role in military affairs in the region. By about 2-1, we would like to see Japan play a greater role. The Japanese do not. Now, I will tell you, though, that the Americans are divided on this. In other words, it's not about as many Americans are not so sure they want Japan to play a bigger role. So it's a relative difference, but not among Americans any absolute difference. Because this is the 70th anniversary of the end of World War II, we wanted to try to assess what role did World War II play in the consciousness of both Americans and Japanese. And I think we found some very very interesting results. We gave people a list of events that had taken place over the last 70 years. And we said, what comes to mind first when you think about the U.S.-Japan relationship? What was interesting is that Americans, 31% of Americans said World War II, 31% of Americans said the tsunami, and there wasn't a whole great deal of consciousness about anything else in between. As someone who cut his teeth in U.S.-Japan relations during the trade wars, I found it interesting that only 8% of Americans cited the trade wars as something they remember as a significant event in the U.S.-Japan relationship over the last 70 years. Interestingly enough, the Japanese had a different view. It is the alliance that first came to mind when they thought about their relationship. I can tell you, frankly, I expected the Japanese to focus more on the war than the Americans did. So I think that was an interesting finding of the survey right out of the gate. We ask people, do you think Japan has apologized sufficiently for World War II, its activities in World War II? Has it not apologized sufficiently, or is no apology necessary? What is interesting is that 61% of Americans say that Japan has apologized sufficiently, or there's nothing to apologize for, which I think would suggest possibly the respondent thought, why are you asking me this question? It was 70 years ago. That's roughly comparable to what we found in Japan when we asked the question, in 2013. Basically, we both have put the war behind us. I can tell you this is not the case in other parts of Asia, especially Northeast Asia. In that 2013 survey, we found that 78% of Chinese and 98% of Koreans said that Japan had not apologized sufficiently for World War II. So there's a real difference there. As an aside, I can also tell you that we ask Americans whether the Germans had apologized sufficiently for World War II. And in fact, the Americans believe the Japanese have apologized more than the Germans. An ongoing issue is the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki with atomic weapons in 1945. For any of you who have traveled much in Japan, you'll know that it tends to come up in conversations with Japanese. And I do think that for a long time, we just saw this episode differently. Americans, I think, took a very pragmatic view of it. The Japanese took a more moral view of it. We found this year that 56% of Americans still believe that the bombing was justified. But I can tell you that percentage has changed dramatically over the 70 years. In 1945, Gallup, right after the bombing, Gallup asked the American public, do you think this was justified? 85% said yes, 10% said no. In 1991, the question was asked again by the Detroit Free Press, and 63% of Americans said it was justified. Today, only 56% believe it is justified. And if you dig into our 56% number, among millennials, those who are ages 18 to 29, only 47% believe that it was justified. So things are really changing in the United States on this issue. They're also changing in Japan. The percentage of Japanese who believe it was unjustified keeps going up. But we seem to be moving here in the United States on this issue as much as the Japanese are. That was our look back in the survey. If you look at the current state of the current situation and look forward, which is what we wanted to do as well, because history is only part of the relationship, we ask Americans, do you trust Japan? As I said, two-thirds of Americans say they have trust in Japan. What is interesting is that it's an across-the-board trust. There's no terribly significant differences among various demographic subsets of the American population. It is interesting that men trust Japan more than women. Whites trust Japan more than non-whites. Those who are better educated tend to trust Japan more than those who are less educated. Interesting to kind of think through why that might be, but overall, we still, two-thirds of Americans are trusting of Japan, and there's absolutely no partisan difference on this issue. Democrats, Republicans, independents overwhelmingingly trust Japan. There's also overwhelming trust of the Japanese, of America. You get some of the same breaks, though, at least a gender break, where men are more likely to trust the United States than women among Japanese. You don't get much of a break in any of the other demographic categories. I can tell you, around the world, there tend to be, on a variety of measures, a gender break on some of these issues that relate to globalization. Men seem to be more open to the world than women. Maybe more reckless in their openness to the world, you don't know, more trusting, I don't know. But the reality is there does seem to be a bit of a gender break on this. Men tend to trust trade more than women, they tend to trust foreign investment more than women. But it may have nothing to do with Japan, per se, more to do with women being a little more wary of change and the dangers that the world may present. Obviously, one of the key issues in any analysis of our relationship is the economic relationship. We know from past surveys that more than 7 in 10 Americans would like to increase trade with Japan. I dare say we don't have the data to compare, but I would, for those of you who are around for the trade wars in the 1980s, I cannot imagine that 70% of Americans in the 1980s wanted to increase trade with Japan. One of the reasons it does seem that we now want or are supportive of increasing trade with Japan is that we no longer see Japan as an unfair trader. In 1989, 63% of Americans thought Japan traded unfairly. Today, only 24% believe that. That's a huge shift. And I can tell you, if you graph this, and you graph first the percentage of the overall U.S. trade deficit that is with Japan, that's gone down steadily as the percentage of our trade deficit with China has gone up. This parallels that graph of our trade deficit. In other words, people might not know what our trade deficit with Japan is, but they get a sense that it's not as bad as it used to be in terms of their perception of it being unfair or fair. By the same token, we now think China's an unfair trader. We are much more likely to say that China trades unfairly than Japan. This leads us to a question of the elephant in the room, and that's China. How do we both see China? What role does it play in our relationship going forward? We ask people, given the rise of China militarily and economically, do you think this makes the U.S.-Japan relationship more important, less important, or makes no difference? Overwhelmingly, Americans say it makes the U.S.-Japan relationship more important. The Japanese say the same thing about the United States. Nevertheless, Americans say if you're forced to choose between improving the economic relationship with Japan or China, they choose China. Now, this reflects, I think, earlier survey research we've done where Americans may not trust China, but they also believe that China has an economy that's as large as the United States, and they believe that China will soon surpass the United States as a superpower. In a very American, pragmatic way, we feel the need to get closer to them economically. I can tell you, when you ask this question in Japan, the Japanese overwhelmingly say they want a closer relationship with the United States, and that may in part reflect the fact that they also believe that the United States is the world's leading economic power, not China. So there is that the result of that different perception. When we ask people about Japan's future military role in the region, which of course is, while we don't mention China in this question, that clearly what this is all about. Americans are divided on this issue, but as I will remind you, the Japanese were really against it. Finally, we asked people, we wanted to get a sense of how the average person who doesn't think a lot about Japan's military role in Asia, doesn't think a lot about TPP or things of that nature, the shift to Asia by the Obama administration, but basically, we wanted to get a sense of the stereotypes in people's minds. What do they think about in the limited amount of time they might actually devote to thinking about Japan? Bearing in mind the stereotypes, which have a very negative connotation in English, are in fact very prevalent. People, rightly or wrongly, have attitudes about each other. And these can inform their broader emotions. What we found was that American stereotypes about Japan are fairly positive. We think the Japanese are hardworking, that they're inventive, and they're honest. The Japanese stereotypes of Americans are maybe a little less positive. They aren't so sure we're hardworking. They think we're aggressive, and they think we're a bit selfish. But stereotypes are stereotypes. And as I say, it's an interesting insight into what the average person thinks about the other. We also ask people, give us one word. If you think about, if I mention to you Japan, what's the first word that comes to your mind? As you can see, it's sushi or food. It's the single, now I can tell you, when I was growing up, no one knew what sushi was. So this is not necessarily negative. World War II comes high in the list. But what's interesting is how little Pearl Harbor is mentioned. This is 15 people out of 1,000 mentioned that. So I would have expected Pearl Harbor actually to play a larger role in people's memories. But those were, again, this is kind of fun. It just gives you a sense of what people are thinking. All of this data is available on our website. There's far more questions that I could get into. The most important part about it is it's free, and it's also searchable, so that you can go in and type in a question and say, gee, have they ever asked the Japanese or have they ever asked the Americans a particular question? You can find the answer going back several decades. So thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, Bruce. Really appreciate that. That's some fascinating information. And when we first got to know each other about more than 30 years ago, the results on surveys were not quite as positive as they are now, but the world has changed. So let's turn now to Satu Lume.
Well, good morning, and it's a real pleasure to be here, and thank you very much for the opportunity to be a participant in this program. it's a really, as Bruce said, a real opportunity to take stock of the U.S.-Japan relationship, both the achievements, the changes in attitudes, and in the case of the project that I'm going to talk about for a few minutes, the way that Japan matters for the United States across states, congressional districts, across various variables. And we've built a database. Bruce said that the Pew product that he's released is free and searchable, and so is the Japan Matters for America website, which I will demonstrate in a few moments, but let me say a few things. First, let me start by thanking Admiral Blair, Kazuo, and Dan, and the Sasakawa Peace Foundation USA for support of this project. Financial, to be sure, but really more importantly, thank you for your collaborative work, for working with us on design and helping us think through options of ways to represent information, et cetera. I also want to thank the Japan-U.S. Friendship Commission, which helped us support part of the website, the interactive website. And very importantly, I want to thank all my colleagues at the East-West Center in Washington who did a tremendous amount of data and analytical work through huge spreadsheets in designing very complicated code and architecture on the website, as you'll see. So those are my thanks. Let me just say a couple things. The theme, overall theme this morning is images and reality. And Bruce took a wonderful cut at both images and reality through his public opinion polling and the results. We've taken a slightly different tack. What we have done is really look at some of the data and then the analysis of that data and the way in which Japan impacts and interacts with the United States, not only at the national level, but really by state and congressional district level. And so this is kind of a reality-based approach to this. Let me explain what the products of this initiative are, and I'm going to talk about two today, but I'll just mention there are really three products. One is the website, which you see here. The second is a set of publications, and there's a Japan one, and a new Japan one will come out in September. So just stand by. It'll be about 40, 50 pages. We don't know exactly how it'll all shake out. And then there are the one-pagers, which you may have seen downstairs. And these are available for every state and congressional district. So those are the products. And let me talk about the first two. As Bruce, as Dan mentioned, this product is, Japan is part of this Asia Matters for America project. So we've done the same thing for Asia as a whole, for the Association of Southeast Asian Nations. Then, of course, you see Japan, which I'll talk about, South Korea, Australia. We're working on China, India, and Taiwan. So those are in progress. So I just wanted to let you know where this sits. And we hope that this is a tool not just as a one-off or a one report, but sort of an ongoing living tool that people will use for a variety of activities, which I'll be happy to talk about how it's being used across the country today. Why do this project? Because there was a sense when I returned to Washington that there's a lot of wonderful policy and elite expertise on the U.S.-Japan relationship. But what struck me is still how important Japan was as I traveled around the United States. And this came concurrently with the narrative of China's rise, and to some extent, you know, the sort of flip side of that was Japan's decline. So it was a useful way of testing the proposition, really, is how important is Japan to the United States? Of course, we can talk about the big strategic and defense and alliance issues, but how do Americans interact with the U.S.-Japan relationship? And it's clear that most Americans, most of the time, do not interact with the U.S.-Japan relationship in the alliance context or in defense policy guidelines or a reinterpretation of the Constitution. Most Americans, most of the time, interact with Japan through civil society links, educational links, tourism, commercial relations, investment, trade, travel. So we wanted to try and capture that. So that's the kind of the driver. And it sort of addresses some of the, I think, false narratives that China has supplanted Japan in the United States, or that Japan is not significant anymore for the US. So let me talk you through some of the big highlights, and then I'll demonstrate the site so you can use it and run through it at your leisure and take a look at what's there and how you might use it. First of all, we can go through all kinds of statistics which will bore you to death about how many states rank Japan as number three for their trade relationship or how many investors. Basically, the findings are as follows. One is that Japan is hugely important nationally at the state level and congressional district level for almost every state and congressional district. in one way or another. Second, that Japan is not important only to a small set of states or a geographically concentrated group of states. It's important across the United States. And that was a finding, especially if you do it on per capita basis or if you do it on a growth basis. And again, it depends on which variable you're looking at. Is it, if it's not students, if it's trade, if it's investment, if a new plant has been built in that district, et cetera, et cetera. The third is that Japan is not significant only on one or two issues, like investment or like trade. It's very important on sister city and civic relationships. It's very important on tourism. It's very important on cultural exchanges. So it's a wide swath of areas in which citizens of our country interact with Japan, not just a couple of areas. I will say three or four highlights. Every state in the United States in 2013 exported at least $30 million of goods to Japan, which is an awful lot for each state. Nearly 50% of all US states had exports to Japan that supported more than 10,000 jobs. In 76% of states, we found that visitor spending from Japan was above $50 million. So one could go on and on about this. You can adjust it for growth rates. You can adjust it for per capita. You can adjust it for changes. You can adjust it for comparative basis. But the bottom line is that across all of these variables, every state and congressional district had a stake in the U.S.-Japan relationship to a greater or lesser degree across numerous factors. And that sort of is a very, I think, a significant way of looking at this. Let me now just turn to, and I'll be happy to give you more. Let me just show you how the site works. So let me first go to, I'll come back to the interactive data. The first thing to note is this site is a repository not only for the interactive data, graphs, charts, and one-page summaries that I showed you and will show you again, but it's also the place to get news, information, and articles about local U.S.-Japan connections. So I'm just going to go to articles, and if I'm lucky, this will all work perfectly. So you'll see that we cover articles under three areas: education and exchange, trade and investment, and politics and security. So this is a series of articles, and I'd urge you, this is one on Kentucky-Japan ties. Of course, the First Lady's recent trip, art in Minneapolis-St. Paul. There's a story, I think, I'm looking from a distance, but Indiana-Japan educational exchange. So this is where we put posts from around the country, and we'll be working with journalism schools and others to constantly post updated news information about U.S.-Japan connections. And so we're looking at working with several journalism schools. So that's one thing I wanted to show you. The second thing I wanted to show you, and of course, like any website, it's always in the process of being updated and amended, but these are graphics that are non-interactive, and you'll see a list of them. And we're constantly creating new information visuals and graphics to post on this element of the site, again, highlighting the U.S.-Japan relationship. The third area I just wanted to show you is publications. So if you want to download when these are all of the publications. We released Australia up on Capitol Hill a couple weeks ago, ASEAN, Korea, Japan. The Japan one, as I said, in September we plan to release a new one, so it'll be downloadable here. There's some of the earlier versions. And then let me go back up here and show you the main site, interactive. So this site allows you to compare your state or states around you, but not yet congressional districts, for which entirely new software will be required. But in any case, let me just show you. Across this band, you can search. So right here, it's trade. So these are the major goods exports to Japan. And if you want to, for example, compare two states, let's take my state, Washington. And can someone tell me, am I in Virginia?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I can't see it from this angle.
That was West Virginia.
West Virginia. Okay. Thanks. Can't see it from this angle. Let me de-click. So down here, you can now compare the relative distribution of those trade components and goods You can also use the time series data. We have done it to 5 years, but eventually you'll be able to do it maybe 10 years. And we're also looking at a way that you can put Japan in the context of 5 other countries in Asia and globally, a global figure. So this will be a very useful way for people to contextualize the importance of Japan for their state, their district, and nationally, not only bilaterally, but in a global context and in the context of key U.S. partners in the Asia Pacific. And I think what you'll find there still is very interesting account of how important Japan still remains. Now, you can do all kinds of songs and dances. You can do jobs, students. I could go on and on, but I really urge you to spend 5 minutes on the site. It's so very easy to remember. It's asiamattersforamerica.org/Japan. And you can go straight to the site. It should be on all of the printed material as well that's been given to you. So those are the main topics. You can also go into individual states. And these are heat maps for how significant Japan factors into that state. Let me do one other thing. Let me go to your downloadable. This is the congressional districts and states. Currently, we have one-page summary profiles for Japan, Asia as a whole, and for ASEAN. So again, to just take my state as an example, you can click on that and print out your one-page PDF of Japan's impact on Washington State. In due course, we will be able to do some more nifty things on this. Again, you have to build the architecture. Remember that embedded in the back of this architecture website is all of the data for 5 years across all these variables for 50 states and 435 congressional districts. So it takes some time to load them in Excel and run the computations that work. And I will say this up front, if you find a bug, if you find a discrepancy or an idiosyncrasy that you can't explain, let us know, because we're constantly checking and figuring it. There are calculation mistakes done on the back end of the website that we need to adjust for. So there is a way of looking at the profile. Let me just end, because my time is almost up. Let me end with a couple of caveats and first of all, I always say about this project, this is not physics. So please don't expect precision. These are numbers that we use from reputable sources. That means almost always where possible, either US government or Japan government databases. We do work with a company called Trade Partnership in cases where we cannot assign value to geographic areas because many variables aren't collected by geographic areas. And I don't want to say anything about how we get our congressional districts, but they change, and therefore allotting value to them is not necessarily a question of calculus or mathematics. It's a question of distribution, either by zip code or by county or by port. There's lots of ways methodologically. And of course, the site has a full explanation of all the methodologies we use for every variable, so we can explain how we got to that number. And I would just use the numbers as round bases, but they do give us an ongoing comparative basis. And the final thing I'll close with is a kind of positive, but also a limitation. The positive is that I don't believe the work we've done here on the importance of Japan actually reflects just how important Japan is. Obviously, it can't capture all of the political, security, international relations importance of Japan. But even on economics, there are limitations. Let me give you an example that we constantly encounter and haven't found a workaround. I'd welcome a solution to. It is very difficult to get investment data at the state or congressional district level. It's near impossible. We use databases for companies. You can geographically GPS code their address and then assign value. Some investment numbers are suppressed for proprietary reasons because companies don't want to release them. There are multiple methodological problems. But we can say with a fair degree of confidence how many employees Japanese firms do employ overall in the United States. We can say that the United States receives about 30% of Japanese foreign direct investment. We can say that the US is the number one destination for that foreign direct investment. So that's one limitation. The second big limitation is many people talk about the sort of flatlining of US-Japan trade. And it's true. I mean, it depends on the year, it depends on the state, et cetera. But let's say that's true. I think it doesn't sufficiently account for a couple of variables for U.S.-Japan trade. One is that as Japan companies have offshored their production facilities throughout Asia, much of U.S.-Japan bilateral trade in the production and supply chain is not being caught in the bilateral nexus, right? It can't be counted because its value in a production supply chain. Your guess is as good as mine how to account for that. I generally work on a mathematical model and this, looking at this and breaking down the Asian Development Bank Institute of the iPhone, which I'm using as a stopwatch, by the way. I've got 3 minutes. If you take the iPhone as a kind of stand-in for all U.S.-Japan trade, which is obviously is not, you can account some share of that value to add on to the U.S.-Japan trade, just as the Asian Development Bank Institute did for U.S.-China trade. So I would add another 20-25% if you add value that's produced by offshore Japanese companies. The second thing this is very difficult to capture, I think, which shows the significance of U.S. and Japan, is company tie-ups, mergers and acquisitions, cross-relationships on innovation and R&D. And again, these are very difficult to capture because many of them are proprietary and very difficult. There's no set database where you can achieve them. Having said those limitations, I do think, and I'll make sort of the pitch, as it were, that the site overall, and you just click back here and you can go back to the site, does allow you to get a fairly good look at the continuing significance of Japan across the United States. So I'd be happy to address any questions or comments, but this I hope will be useful to you, and I do hope you'll spend a few moments of your precious time on maybe trolling around the website, trying to play with it interactively, see if you can print out the graphics, et cetera. And again, we look forward to your suggestions and comments on improving it further. With that, thank you very much, Dan.
Well, thank you very much, Satu. That was really, really well done. Really appreciate it. We thought what we would do now is just take a very quick coffee break for about 10 minutes, and you can sort of try and absorb some of the information that you've received, and then we're going to come back and kick things off with Ambassador Schieffer and Mr. Akita and talk about what their analysis, interpretation of what all this means. So 10 minutes and we'll start again. Okay, for this part of the program, we're going to get into some analysis and discussion about the results that we've just heard about. And we want to kick things off with Ambassador Schieffer I think he'll be speaking from the stage here. So, Ambassador Schieffer, over to you.
Well, thank you, Dan. It's great to be with you again. Dan Bob is not a Texan, but I know that if he went to Texas, he would be welcome. Now, people would ask him what his last name was, but he would be welcome. I think this is a very interesting survey, and I think there's a lot of good news in it. And I don't say this any irony in it, but I think we can say that the war is finally over between the United States and Japan. And I don't say that lightly, because I think, as the survey also shows, there is still a legacy of war in Northeast Asia in particular. And it is one that has not been overcome. I think the great lesson here is what the United States and Japan did to have this situation where 68% of Americans trust Japanese, 75% of Japanese trust Americans. I think what we decided to do early on was talk about the future and not the past. And because we talked about the future, we didn't forget the past. But because we talked about the future, we talked about creating institutions and a culture of working together that permeates this whole survey. Now, one of the things that I find very interesting in the survey is on the stereotypes. It is not hard for me to think that Americans, 94-95% of Americans, think that the Japanese are hardworking. It is also not a surprise to me to see that the Japanese at 24-25%, whatever it is, think Americans are not as hardworking. I would venture to say that the Japanese are the hardest working people in the world. And while I wish they thought we worked harder, I'm not surprised that they don't think so, but I would guess that they might be surveyed on other countries as well and might not think they're as hardworking either. And I think that has to do with Japan and its desire to make every minute count. So I don't worry about that too much. One of the things that I find ironic, though, in the survey is on the question of honesty. Here you have Japan trusting the United States at a 75% level, and yet on honesty, 37%, only 37% of Japanese think that the American people are honest. I don't see how you get to that conclusion. How can you be trustworthy and not be honest? But I think that also is a legacy of some of the post-war, Americans are perceived as much more aggressive by Japanese than Japanese are perceived by Americans. Those two things, honesty and aggressiveness, I think may have something to do with one of the unfortunate parts of American-Japanese relationships since the end of the war, and that is gaiatsu, or the understanding that what does America want? What does America demand? And I think too often in our relationship, that has driven a lot of our politics, a lot of our relationship. And it's a political game in many respects. Americans are sometimes, Americans in policymaking positions are sometimes encouraged by Japanese to make their views public so that the Japanese can respond as, what choice did we have? Now, that has given Japanese politicians some cover in the past. We have a relationship that has worked very well, so you can't just say, well, we shouldn't go down that road. But I think we've reached a point now in which we should stop relying on that kind of policy making on both sides. I think it is extraordinarily important for the Japanese people to understand that it is not what America demands of Japan, it is what the Japanese feel is in their best interest. And that's what should drive our relationship as we go forward. We have gone far beyond that period when Japanese should think that America demands that they be a partner in an alliance. I think we've reached the point where we really should approach the future alliance on a partnership basis of equal partners. Now, I think it is remarkable that Prime Minister Abe has made some of the forays that he has in the areas of defense and security. And when you talk about collective self-defense, and the Japanese are obviously still in conversation about it, they still have some reservations about it, but collective self-defense to me is an extraordinarily important issue, because what it says is that Japan, in very limited circumstances, will come to the aid of the United States if the United States were attacked. I think that is really important, because the future of our alliance cannot be so one-sided that only the United States has to come to the defense of Japan. There has to be some sort of reciprocity. In the Cold War, it didn't make a difference because the timeline was such that Japan couldn't respond. If a nuclear missile was launched in Soviet Union against the United States, there wasn't much that Japan could do about that. Technology has changed that to where now you have missile defense on both our sides, and Japan can come to the defense of the United States if a missile is launched toward the United States and a Japanese destroyer, for instance, could knock it down. I think it would be very difficult for the American people to understand if a Japanese destroyer had a chance to knock down a missile headed for the United States and didn't take it because under a strict interpretation of the security agreement, they don't have to. But if that missile landed on American soil, I think it would be very difficult for Americans to understand how an ally could allow that to happen. So I think that is a big, big issue. And I think Japan is moving in a very forthright way to try to fill in some of those gaps that exist. But again, that is something that the Japanese people have to decide is important for their security, not just for ours, but their security. And I think this survey shows you that there is a movement toward a recognition in Japan of the need to make some changes in the security posture. I thought the economic issues were very interesting with regard to what had happened here, particularly on the trade wars. And I agree with Dan, in the 80s and 90s, if this survey were taken, the results would have been very different. But the Japanese did something that was very wise, and that is they recognized that just exporting product to the United States was causing a problem. And so what they did was they made a huge move toward investing in the United States. Now 75% of the Toyotas that are made in America, that are sold in America, are made in America. It makes a big difference when an American works at a Toyota factory or a Japanese factory, and the Japanese are creating jobs in America, which they clearly have done. And all of a sudden, trade is much more understandable. It's much more a part of the process and not something to be demonized on the part of the other country. Hopefully, that trend that you see reflected in this poll will be continued with the TPP negotiations, and that we will truly have two economies that are integrated in a way that they have not been in the past. I think that will have even greater influence on the poll it's taken 10, 15, 20 years from now than it is shown here. But clearly, we don't have that animosity. We don't have that problem that we had 20, 30 years ago. I want to say something about the politics of that is reflected in this. And it's not something I'm proud of, but I think it is something that all of us in this room need to be aware of. I would guess that most of the people that are here today think about Japan a lot. Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. Unfortunately, I'm afraid it creates an elite as opposed to a large public awareness. In this survey, if you go back to the back, it talks about Japanese and the sushi is the leading thing that Americans think about when they think about Japan. Well, I like sushi. I liked sushi before I went to Japan. I like it. I still like it. I realize how much better it is in Japan than it is in the United States now, but I still like it. But when you look down and people are asked, and it's a very small sampling, it's 100 of the 1,000 sampling, but when people are asked to what they think of Prime Minister Koizumi, Prime Minister Abe, 12% of Americans have a favorable view of Prime Minister Koizumi. 11% have a favorable view of Prime Minister Abe. 9% have an unfavorable. 73% never heard of either one of them. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a prescription for disaster on a long-term basis. Americans have to become more aware of the rest of the world than they are today. This does not pertain only to Japan when I say this, but one thing that I noticed when I served in Australia and in Japan is a problem that I don't have a solution for. But the presidential primaries in the United States are front page news in Australia and Japan. I'm talking about the caucuses, the primaries, who's up, who's down, and all that. They're lucky to make any page of the paper in the United States. Now, I think part of that is explainable by the fact that the United States has been the dominant power in the world since the end of the war. And so countries all over the world are interested in what we're doing and in the face of what we're doing. But Americans need to be less focused on themselves and more focused on the larger world that we live in. That would be good for the United States and for the rest of the world. Now, having said that, I think we've done a pretty good job. I think the world is a much different and a much better place than it was at the end of the war. And I think the role that the United States has played in that war, in making that happen, is something that all Americans could be proud of. But I don't take comfort when I see the numbers so low as the awareness of Americans about specific things that are going on in Japan. And I think that that is a challenge to everybody in this room to try to figure out how we can get the message that the elites are aware of out to a broader public. Because in the end, I look out on Northeast Asia and I see a United States and Japan that share the same common ground on the future. And I say that in this way. I think United States policy in Northeast Asia might change with regard to some situations. If you look at the Korean Peninsula, for instance, if the Korean Peninsula were united, our policy might be somewhat different than it is today toward South Korea, for instance. Not that it would be worse, not that it would be bad, it just might be different. If you look at the situation with Taiwan and China, if there were a reconciliation between China and Taiwan, I think our policy toward Taiwan might be different. Doesn't mean it would be worse, might be better, but I think it might be different. But I don't see a place anywhere in Northeast Asia where the interest of Japan and the interest of the United States are going to cause a difference in long-term strategic policy toward one another. I just don't. And so I am very happy to see that the U.S.-Japan alliance is so highly regarded in both places and is regarded as important to the security of both places. So I end, I hope, on that happy note.
Thank you, Ambassador Schieffer. Really appreciate that. And now to our final speaker, Mr. Akita from Nikkei.
Thank you. I just borrowed a very expensive watch of Ambassador Schieffer. This shows how a friendship between U.S. and Japan is strong. Thank you. So thank you very much for inviting me today. I'm very honored to be here. And I'm also very glad to know that the stereotype image of Japanese from American point of view is hardworking and inventive. But I think that the Japanese journalist is unfortunately maybe less hardworking or less could be less inventive. But so I'm not sure to how much extent I'm qualified to represent Japanese average view. But I, at least in this room, I try to be a very hardworking Japanese journalist. So anyway, mainly based on the Pew Research poll result, I'd like to make three comments. One is about the U.S. and American perception difference, or maybe gap, about Asian security situation. Second, I'd like to also mention that to how much extent Japanese public support very proactive security policy initiated by Prime Minister Abe. And thirdly, in that context, I'd like to touch upon the Japanese public view on the US-Japan alliance. So please look at this poll. This is a poll conducted by Cabinet Office this January. And this shows that how Japanese people worried about its security situation, being asked if there is a risk for Japan to be caught or involved in a war. 28% of people think that there is a risk, and 47% of the people think that there is a risk in some degree. So this number is very big. 75% of Japanese public think that there could be a danger that Japan will be caught in the war. This poll also asked the reason why. And most Japanese people answered that there is a more tension on conflict in the world. They didn't specifically mention about what region or which country, but as we observe from Tokyo, Chinese military activity is becoming more and more visible in South China Sea or East China Sea. I'm not criticizing it, but I'm just telling facts. And also, North Korean nuclear program is getting accelerated. And Japan is within the range of a ballistic missile of North Korea. And so Japanese people, it's kind of like a natural for Japanese people to worry more about its security. But as Pew poll results show, American public perception about Japanese security situation is a little bit different, or quite different. It shows that only little American public know, or American public knows only little about the tension between Japan, China over Senkaku Island, or what is going on in Korean Peninsula. And I think it is very natural, because after all, US is a very far away from Asia, and the US is separated by the ocean. So I think that it is natural, different political location create different perception. But let me touch up. So this poll shows the kind of like a difference of perception between US and Japan. And this is a poll conducted by Yomiuri newspaper and Gallup jointly last November. And they asked about the source of potential military threat. And Japan, Japanese public think that China is first, biggest. And then North Korea, and then Russia. And strange, I think it is very strange, but fourth is South Korea. I don't think that South Korea will invade Japan. Though we have a history problem, we are a friendly country, but sometimes poll shows a very strange result. So anyway, it's a mystery. And then American public think that China is fourth threat, less threatening than North Korea. And of course, Middle East is the biggest threat for American. Still, I think that it is very natural. But I think that as Ambassador Schiffer mentioned, that this perception gap or difference of the perception could be a source of a friction in the future if US and Japan wants to coordinate its security policy more closer, or if there is some contingency in Asia. And then next question is that, so this sense of vulnerability by Japanese public, how is it being translated into their attitude toward the proactive security policy led by Prime Minister Abe? And we can, some may assume that since Japan is more worried about its own security, so Japanese people are more inclined to support more proactive security policy by Abe administration. But or maybe some people assume that since Japan feel worried about Japanese security, it will stimulate Japanese nationalism and then maybe that make Japan lean toward more right politically. But this poll shows that is not the, at least a poll shows that is not the case. Asked about whether they will support expansion of overseas operations by self-defense forces, these two polls conducted last month shows that Japanese public is highly divided, almost even, favorable and unfavorable. And same thing can be said about collective self-defense. Ambassador Schiffer mentioned, Prime Minister Abe is trying to pass legislation for Japan to be able to exercise collective self-defense for the first time after the war, World War II. And he already changed the interpretation of the Constitution to make it possible last July. Then asked about the legislation to exercise collective self-defense. It's also very divided. Nikkei, Asahi, Mainichi, NHK, all polls shows that 20 to 30 people are supportive, favorable, but 50% or 40% of people are unfavorable. So I think that there is a discrepancy between Japanese threat perception or sense of vulnerability and its attitude toward security policy. Japanese people worried, but they are still cautious for Japan to expand overseas military operations. even though Prime Minister Abe is trying to do it to further strengthen U.S.-Japan security cooperations, and also he intends to do more to contribute stability, peace and stability in the region. So I wonder why. Then maybe let's skip revision of the Constitution. I think that the one easiest answer is Pacific Constitution given by United States is too good. And so Japanese people, Pacific sentiment of Japanese people is still very deep-rooted, and they remain the same. In other words, Japanese people, public, may think this way. They are very, very willing to. Another poll shows that Japanese public fully support for stronger U.S.-Japan alliance, and Japanese public fully support that policies to do more to further strengthen U.S.-Japan security cooperation in the context of rise of China or North Korean crisis. And Japanese people also more or less support increase of defense budget. Now Japanese defense budget is to GDP ratio is like a 0.8%, but I think that Japan can expand it much more, at least to the level of the 1% or 1.5. Public is not opposing to that, but they worry that once break is removed, maybe overseas operation will expand without any limit. So they still there is still this kind of a concern. But I think a second reason, and which is more relevant reason, is that credibility of U.S.-Japan security treaty is very, very strong. And this poll shows that, they ask about U.S.-Japan Security Treaty, is it helpful for the security in Asian Pacific? Not only the defense of Japan, but the Asian Pacific. And 27 Japanese people think that it is very helpful, and 46% relatively helpful. So About 75% of Japanese people believe that U.S.-Japan Security Treaty is helpful not only for Japan, but also for Asian security region. It is, this number is 10% higher than that of American public respondent. So whether it is good or bad, I think that Japanese people fully, Japanese people's credibility to this alliance is so strong that they believe that we can still rely on this treaty or this alliance. So maybe that is one of the reasons of the discrepancy. Lastly, I think I have a few minutes, so please let me explain, touch upon the revision of the Constitution in this context. Prime Minister, Abe administration is trying to create momentum for the more vital, active discussion for the revision of the Japanese Constitution. And this poll conducted in this January shows that public is highly divided. 30, according to a Nikkei poll, maybe 40% are favorable, a little bit less than 40% favorable, and 45% unfavorable. And the Yomiuri poll shows that 51% favorable and 46% unfavorable. But I think that this number is still quite high. Maybe in 20 or 30 years ago, a favorable number would was maybe much lower, I think. So it is high, as I more than I imagined. But still, it's highly divided. But when asked about specifically, when poll asked about specifically Constitution Article 9, which renounces a war, vast majority of Japanese people say they don't want to change it. So it is very puzzling. Japanese, half or one-third of Japanese people wants to revise Constitution, but they don't want to revise Article 9, which is the essence, Pacific essence of Article 9. So it is very strange, not strange, puzzling, but I think this way. When I was a kid, you know, my mother always choose clothes for me to wear. But as we grown up, we want to choose clothes, what to wear, decide what to wear by myself. Then we, now Japan won't do it. But the clothes, design of the design or color of the clothes, Japan wants to choose is same as the one which was given by the United States, more or less. But the action to decide by itself and choose and adopt is very, very important for Japan. Maybe I think that this number shows that this reality. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Akita-san. Really appreciate those comments. And now we'd like to get into a discussion amongst our panelists before we open to the floor. And if I might just begin with a question. As we all know, Prime Minister Abe is here in 3 weeks or so. He'll be making the first official trip by a prime minister in 9 years, partly as a result of many short-term prime ministers not having had the ability to come here. But as Ambassador Schieffer mentioned, 73% of Americans don't know who Mr. Abe is. He'll be giving a speech the first time ever before a joint session of Congress for a Japanese prime minister. And based on some of the background that we've been discussing today, I'm just curious if any of you might have some thoughts on the sorts of things that he might want to cover in his speech before a joint session of Congress, or more generally while he's here. He'll also be, of course, in addition to Washington, in Boston, in San Francisco, and in Los Angeles. But just wondering if any of you had some thoughts on that.
Since I'm only Japanese here, so maybe I'm responsible to answer first. I think that the Abe's Prime Minister, I think that speech at the joint session is one of the most important events in Washington. Because while German Prime Minister or South Korean President have made a speech like five times, but it is first time for a Japanese Prime Minister to make a speech at the joint session. So there is a symbolism. But the substance is also important. As we discussed, Prime Minister Abe seeks for more active, proactive security policy to do more to contribute to the stability and peace and stability in the region. For example, collective defense, right? Self-defense. So he wants to send a message that now Japan also thinks that this alliance is not only for bilateral, but global. Not only in the domain of security, but also environment, or TPP. Well, there are many elements. So they want to send that message to the Congress. And also, in order for future-oriented relation, we have to have a very correct recognition about the past. So I think that he will also mention about history. And it's very difficult to predict his wording. As a journalist, I think that that is one of the most risky things to do is to predict what leader will say in coming weeks. But I think he will touch upon history too. Thank you.
Ambassador.
I agree with Akita-san that this is a big speech for the Prime Minister, and it is anticipated, been anticipated in Japan for a long time. I think the Prime Minister's, and not this specific speech, but the 70th anniversary of the end of the war, as to what he should say in the year that that occurs. So I think that he looks upon, I don't know, I don't certainly don't speak for him, but I think he has to speak in a way about history. I think we have seen by this survey that history is really in Americans' rear view mirrors. But having said that, if he doesn't mention history, that will be the headline. And I don't think that's the headline that he wants to make. So I think he needs to say something about the historical issues in a positive way and point out that Japan has been a model citizen of the international community for 70 years, and that ought to count for something. Having said that, I think that the Prime Minister is looking forward to this opportunity and sees it as an opportunity, and I hope that Americans will realize that this is a big speech and that what he wants to do, I believe, is to set the tone for the future and how we can work together and how we share so many values in the world, but we share so many policy goals in the world. And I think that that should be reassuring to Americans, and I hope it is reassuring to the Japanese as well, and I expect it will be.
If I could also just ask, I thought one of the interesting findings, Bruce, was the fact that Americans trust Japan more to play an active military role than the Japanese trust themselves. And I wonder if you could just give a few insights into that, how that may have compared previously and where it may go forward. I mean, it wasn't so long ago, I remember, when just the subject of collective self-defense or constitutional reinterpretation was completely taboo subject 20, 25 years ago. You simply couldn't talk about it. Even editors of major newspapers would not write anything about it. It was just simply taboo.
Well, I think it's an interesting question, and I think one of the we don't have any trend data on this, at least at Pew, so we can't. I thought it was interesting the Kisan's surveys in Japan about basically a division on this, we'd like to do more overseas, but really we don't want to change anything. There's obviously some contradiction in people's emotions about this, which I think is terribly typical. What I found interesting in our survey in the United States is I frankly expected Americans to be more supportive of Japan doing more militarily in the region, simply because we know there's been a long sense in the United States that we bear so many military burdens around the world. We'd like more burden sharing. And given the fact that history does seem to be in the rearview mirror of Americans, the fact that we were actually kind of still divided on this issue, I found a little bit surprising. My guess is that will change and evolve over time as we get further away from the war, as the issue of peace and security in Asia becomes maybe more of an important issue for us. I can only imagine that, again, you don't know what respondents were thinking when you asked them the question. But they could have said, sure, we take on too much of this burden, let the Japanese take more. Well, they didn't say that. Does that mean that there may be still some reticence here that Japan could somehow get us involved in things we'd rather not get involved with in terms of China or whatever? I don't know. I mean, again, you can't. George Gallup used to say, you ask people a question, they give you an answer, don't overinterpret it because you're projecting your own feelings onto what they told you. We don't know why they said this. But it is interesting that they were divided on the issue. I would imagine that will continue to evolve over time because clearly we also know that the American public is weary in terms of the burdens it has taken militarily around the world. I can't imagine that's going to get much better over time. It probably only the weariness will only grow.
Yeah, I explained the poll about the collective self-defense, which is highly divided. But there's another poll which asked a Japanese public that, do you know about the content of the registration? Or do you know about how will Japan exercise collective self-defense in what scenario? Mm-hmm. And I forgot the number, but most of the people don't know. There are many, many reports about new definition of kind of a limited collective self-defense. But it is very, very discussion about the registration and the criteria for Japan to exercise collective self-defense. It's limited. Japan is only when Japan is threatened its survivability, Japan will conduct. So Japanese people don't understand. That is the reason why I think that is one of the reasons why public is divided. But if Japanese public know, were explained that, as Ambassador Shifa said, when U.S. is under attack, when U.S. is patrolling around, when they are patrolling around Japanese, surrounding Japan, near Japan, then self-defense forces, whether self-defense forces should respond. I think that is collective self-defense. I think that more than 90% or 80% of people say that Japan should. But when there is if there are war in the Middle East and there is a mine deployed in the Persian Gulf, and whether Japan should exercise collective self-defense and then sweep it, do mine sweeping in the time of the war, that is also regarded as a use of force. And that is a kind of gray zone. So this kind of discussion is very, very highly complex, and people still, that's the reason why people still. But I think the trend, it's divided, but I think the trend is toward more supportive position, toward more to more proactive security policy. And though it is divided, the trend is more proactive, I think.
Just to follow up on this, how much of that movement in that direction has to do with China's actions?
Related to China's action?
Right.
I think it's highly, deeply related. Japan is a very vulnerable country surrounded by sea, and there are not so many natural resources. So Japan, I think that in past 20 or 30 years, Japanese security policy has been driven by external shock, North Korean nuclear test or North Korean launch of a ballistic missile, and also China's very active military operation. So I think that Japan is not so spontaneously moving, but reactive or adaptive. So.
And Satu, if I could ask you, just sort of impressionistically, you've, as you go through all the materials that you put together, all the statistics and so forth, it's clear how pervasive Japan's been involved in U.S. Across any number of sectors. We didn't do this specifically in the poll, and I'm not sure how easily it could be done, mm-hmm. but how much of that distribution of Japanese companies, the jobs created, and so forth, do you think has created such a, well, really positive view of Japan that's reflected in the poll that Pew did?
Yeah, thanks, Dan. In fact, Bruce and I were just talking about this. Would there be a way to overlap Japan's interactions and quote, footprint or impacts across the U.S. with the polling data? Could you draw a correlation, if not a causation, between the, let's call it the Japan factor locally and the attitudes? You know, this segues a little bit to your first question about Prime Minister Abe's visit. You know, I was thinking of his schedule. You know, it's a bi-coastal schedule. And what really struck me about our data set is, as I said at the outset, is Japan is so important across the United States. So if you disaggregate, and again, you know, in any kind of such type of work, you can do layers upon layers of disaggregation and computation. But the bottom line is, what strikes me is Japan is so important across the United States, whether it's manufacturing across the South, whether it's agricultural issues in the Midwest and other places, certainly for my state, Washington State, huge impact. So while this trip obviously is welcome and the joint session speech is welcome, I was just thinking there would be a great way for the Prime Minister to indicate how important Japan is to the whole of the United States, quite beyond historical. And it's a way of framing the future, too, is what more can be done to further build and strengthen these kinds of dynamics across the country between our two countries.
If I could add, because of the limitations of any survey, you only can interview so many people, you really can't get it state by state in terms of, say, trust of Japan, because the N would not be big enough in any one state to have a statistically significant response. But you can aggregate them by region. And what's interesting in our data, because we've done that, is that the least trust of Japan is in the South, which I must admit I found counterintuitive, because some of the most prominent examples of Japanese job-creating investment in the United States have been in the South, in Tennessee, in Kentucky, Alabama, et cetera. So what that might suggest, and again, it really requires much further analysis, is that kind of an economist's rationality about this all. If you create jobs in our neighborhood, we're going to love you. And it's more complex than that. It may have to do with the fact that we do know that there's lower trust among non-whites than whites of Japan. Bear in mind that they both trust Japan, but there's slightly higher, and maybe because there's a larger non-white population in the South, maybe that's the reason. Maybe it's because there's a lower percentage of Asians in the South. I don't even know if that's true, but it has been suggested to us, and that would be something to look at. Your data would also be very interesting to look at, because it does seem to me that it would be interesting to know why there is some regional difference in the United States, when, as you say, Japan really has had an across-the-board influence the economy of the United States.
Ambassador?
Bruce is a statistician, and statisticians hate anecdotes, so I apologize for this anecdote.
No, I'm a journalist, so I love anecdotes.
but let me give you an anecdote that I think answers some of what you're just raising. The Toyota company opened a truck manufacturing site in San Antonio several years ago. It's a big employer. It's got a lot of publicity. In 2008, when the financial crisis hit, they did something that's very normal for Japanese, not normal for an American company. The production, they were overproduction, they had to stop the production line. They didn't lay anybody off. What they did was they took the workers at the Toyota plant in San Antonio and had them go out into the community and volunteer. And they worked in parks and a number of public institutions. They didn't lay them off. They had them doing something positive for the community. They took it very Japanese. Now let's fast forward to the last congressional election. A very enterprising young Hispanic named Joaquin Castro, they're brothers, twin brothers, was elected to the Congress. Okay? His very first year, there was an effort to launch again a Japan caucus in the Congress. Joaquin is the co-chairman of that caucus. What does that say? That says that, number one, he's a great guy, he's very smart, he's all that, but if the Japanese were very unpopular in San Antonio, he wouldn't be volunteering to be the co-chairman. And one of the things that I think we can do, and I agree with Bruce, I think in the South and really in the Midwest, you will find that Japan is not, there's not as great an awareness about Japan as there are in the two coasts. Mm-hmm. And that's not unusual. I mean, when Australians come to the United States, they stop in Los Angeles, San Francisco, they go to New York, they go to Washington, Boston. And it's the second or third trip before they go to Chicago or Dallas, Fort Worth, or Atlanta, or places like that. And that, I think, is something that we can do better on. Both sides can do better. But where do Americans stop when they go to Japan? Tokyo. We can both be captives of our own cultures here. But I think that, by and large, Japan is becoming more and more, people are becoming more and more aware of Japan because of Japanese investment in America. Mm-hmm. I was in Japan when the Aichi affair was going on. There were 13 state delegations that visited, brought trade delegations to that fair and stopped in Tokyo. You could just count them. The governors, the senators were from states, and the people that accompanied them were from states where there was a major Japanese investment in that state. West Virginia, Tennessee, Texas, places like that. So, I mean, it really does make a difference when we have greater integration of our two economies. And I think that gets back to the trade issue again and the importance of something like the TPP. This really makes a difference when we work together and we benefit from each other's capital and benefit from the relationship.
Thanks. Let me add just one other anecdote about Toyota, actually. When they invested in a major plant, maybe the first plant that they built in the U.S. in the late 80s in Kentucky, a number of states were competing with one another to provide subsidies, lower taxes, and so forth. Kentucky won, and it spent, if memory serves, about $100 million on these things. Incredibly politically controversial. But as soon as they had made the decision, Toyota made a major effort at corporate citizenship. They did recruiting for their new laborers from every single county in the state, and created a whole bunch of jobs, integrated into the community, and within a couple of years, they were beloved by the citizens of the state. And they were sort of on the leading edge of corporate citizenship, but a lot of other Japanese companies quickly learned about that, and it really, I think, helped set a much better tone. And this, of course, was in the midst of the bad old days of the 80s, early 90s, when Japan was going to be taking over the world, ostensibly. Well, let me just give our speakers a chance to comment on anything that any of you have said, if there are any burning questions or thoughts that you wanted to get up, and then we'll open to the floor. Anyone want to add something?
I just wanted to actually reinforce something Ambassador Schieffer said, which is a personal view and has nothing to do with the Pew Research Center's opinion, because we have no opinion about this. But the ambassador's point that Americans need to recognize that the world impacts them in ways that the world never impacted us before. And as a result, we bear a responsibility as citizens to pay attention to the world, to follow the world. Now, that can come off as condescending from elites. I mean, we spend our entire lives worrying about the world, and most people have real lives, and they don't have time to spend as much time as we do thinking about what's happening in faraway places with strange-sounding names. Nevertheless, the consequence of globalization is that things that happen far away impact us in ways that never did before. And I think we all, as citizens, as a result, bear a responsibility for our own self-interest to try to understand the world better. And I can say, as a former journalist, the journalistic community bears a huge responsibility to help us do that. And I can say, as a former journalist, that my profession has let us down. The ambassador can probably comment on how many fewer bureaus there are in Tokyo than there used to be. And that's not just because the world's moved on to China or whatever. It's because the economics of journalism has changed, and we just don't cover the world the way we used to. This is an ongoing challenge. It's one of the reasons we at the Pew Research Center started to do the Global Attitudes Project over a dozen years ago, is we realized we all need to understand public opinion better, not just in the US, not just in Japan, but all over the world. And if we don't, we'll pay a huge price. And I couldn't agree with the ambassador more about the need to take on that responsibility for all of us as citizens.
Just a short comment. The stereotype of US American image by Japanese public is, you know, is not as positive as that of Japanese stereotype image in the United States, as according to Pew Research result. But I don't think that is because, I don't think that means that US American people is less honest than Japanese. But I think that US is dominant power. So there are massive news coverage about what the president say, or what the Secretary of Defense says, or State Department press briefing. And also, there are a lot of massive report about presidential race, or Snowden case, or war in Iraq, or many war in Afghanistan, and so on. So naturally, we compare every remark by president or secretary and so on. And there is some contradicting remarks, of course, politician. But the Japanese politician also make the same very, very contradicting remarks, or there is some scandal by politicians and so on. But it is not covered by CNN or Fox News. This morning, I wanted to know what is going on in the world, so I turned on the CNN. But the most of the news were about trial in Boston, like some crime, which I don't know. So there aren't any world news. So I think that is largely due to the volume of news coverage, and that gap create the differences of the stereotype image, I think.
Okay, well, let's open up to the audience now. We have mics that will be brought to you, and if you can give us your name and affiliation, and keep your comments to a minimum and focus on question, we'd appreciate it. Who'd like to go first? Over here.
Hello. My name's Matt Tranquata, and I'm from Washington Core. I guess I'd like to ask, I know you guys probably hate to speculate, but I'd like to ask you to look one layer deeper at some of the things you've been talking about. I'm curious what you think some of the drivers are for public opinion here, because while we've been talking about the U.S. and Japan, there are a lot of other countries that are also competing in this marketplace of ideas and public diplomacy. And one of the trends, especially in D.C., has been while Japan's presence hasn't totally gone away, there are fewer exchange students here, there are fewer nonprofits that Japan is funding, while other countries like Korea have really upped their public diplomacy game. And countries like China are funding Confucius Institutes around the country and going after people at sort of different parts of our society. So I guess I'm curious what you see, if the Japanese relationship with the U.S. will stay unchanged, or if there are some other drivers that may influence this beyond just investment in different parts of the country.
Well, I do think that the Japanese government recognizes this and is trying to correct that. My sense in talking to Japanese government officials is they're very aware that they need to up their public diplomacy game. The Japanese government has a goal of doubling the number of Japanese students who study abroad, doubling the number of students from abroad who study in Japan, and a lot of those will be American-Japan exchanges, I think. Now, whether that will be successful or not, we don't know, but I do think that it's a sign of recognition that Japan's connection to the world has declined. Certainly in the 80s when I lived in Japan, you could never run into an elite family that wouldn't then brag to you about how their son or their daughter was studying at Harvard. And more recently, there were no undergraduate Japanese students at Harvard. I mean, it's a shockingly a graphic example of what was going on. And I do think that yes, there's a greater competition for this pool of people who might be interested in traveling abroad or living abroad or studying abroad. China's now available; it wasn't available. China's hot. Japan is not as hot. As an issue for younger people, but in that competition of ideas, as you say, and cultural exposure, I think Japan needs to up its game, and I think it's in our self-interest to help support that, because if this is the bar none relationship, we have a self-interest in making sure that at many levels those exchanges are strong.
Yeah, thank you for your question. Yeah, I agree with a lot of what Bruce said. I frame it this way. It seems to me, anyways, as a person who tries to work broadly on Asia, that there's something both positive and sort of disconcerting about this, which is if you look from roughly 1964 onwards, when Japan became a member of OECD, Japan constituted, I'm using this number very loosely, but sort of 90% of everything when it came to U.S. Asia. Right, it came 90% of the economy of Asia, 90% of our interactions on trade and investment and relations with Asia. But Asia's changed. So now you have Japan, Korea as a member of the advanced countries. You obviously have the rise of China. ASEAN as a grouping represents our third or fourth, give or take, biggest trade partner in the region. India, to some extent, is also beginning to make changes. So you have a much more diffuse, diversified growth of Asia as a whole. So the relative place of Japan in that context is by definition decreased. The real question is, if we're future-oriented, is how does Japan build back the economy along with government-directed and private sector programs to reinvigorate the U.S. Japan relationship? And part of what the Japan Matters for America project or the Asia Matters for America project is about is really it also provides a mapping of where that work needs to be done and in what areas it needs to be done. So it can help us kind of calibrate where we need to do more work, whether it's on the commercial side or the cultural side or the exchange side, as Bruce said. So that's how I would sort of frame the contestation of multiple Asian countries trying to be heard in Washington.
Just quickly, I think there's one other thing that we should mention in this context of fewer Japanese students, and that is the demographic challenge that Japan is facing. There are just not as many Japanese students as there used to be. And they're not going, not only are they not going to American universities in the way that they have, they're not going abroad as much as they have because there's just not as many of them. And that makes the challenge even greater for us, that we have to focus on programs that will bring Japanese to America and Americans to Japan. Because without that interaction that we've had, frankly, for 70 years, we're putting at risk this relationship. And it's too valuable to let something like that stand in the way. And so I don't have an answer for it, but I know that we have to be careful that we don't take each other for granted. Mm-hmm. Now, Ryan Schaefer is here from the Mansfield Foundation. I'm on that board. Here is from the American side. Mansfield Fellowships, I think, are one of the great things that we do. And what that is we take mid-career American bureaucrats and take them to Japan. And we used to do that for 2 years. Now we only do that for a year because the funding was cut back. And the idea of that program was to have young Japanese, young Americans grow up together in government and responsibility so that as they attain more responsibility, the older they got, they would have more interaction. If we put at risk programs like that, we put at risk the future. And we have to be creative and we have to be innovating in getting young Japanese, whether they're in higher education or in mid-career, to the United States and vice versa if we're going to be successful in the long run.
Yeah, I think Jerry Curtis, not so long ago, said about something on the order of 30 to 40% of the decline in Japanese students studying here is simply the demographic problems. There's also the cost of U.S. university education, so there's also been a diversion to some other English-speaking countries, New Zealand, Australia, Canada. So.
And what's happening in Japan, which is ancillary to that, is that it's easier to get in good universities in Japan because there's still the infrastructure there, but fewer applicants. And so the Japanese student has the opportunity, some of them, to go to places that they haven't been able to. It's at home. It's cheaper. It's immensely cheaper than it is in the United States, and that's all playing against us. So we got to be aware of that.
Okay. Other questions? In the back in white.
Thank you, reporter from Voice of America. My question is to Mr. Akita-san. I just wondering, could you help me to clarify one thing? And from the very beginning, you mentioned that it seems to me that President Abe's efforts, like revising Japanese constitution, doesn't actually get a lot of support domestically in Japan. And at the end, you mentioned that there is a trend. It's sort of he got more support. And the second, the Pew Research mentioned that the Americans think that Japanese has apologized sufficiently for World War II. So my question is, what does the Japanese public think that they think that they apologize sufficiently? Thank you.
Thank you. Actually I was waiting for that question. As for constitutional revision, I think that it's still highly divided, as Paul shows, and it is more difficult to anticipate trend about the trend about support of related to constitutional revision than support to more proactive security policy, because constitutional revision is a much bigger deal. So I'm not sure that trend is moving will move more toward division or it will remain divided. I'm not so sure about as for the constitutional revision, but for proactive security policy, I think that a trend will be more to be supportive of that. And as for the apology, I think this way. Before that, maybe maybe I should mention about another poll conducted by Yomiuri newspaper in January, and they ask whether Japanese apology for Wartime Act is sufficient or not. And I think that more than 50%, vast majority of people think that it is sufficient. But at the same time, if poll ask if Prime Minister Abe, he's making a statement on August 15th for the 70 years anniversary for the World War II. And specifically about this statement, another poll asked if Prime Minister Abe should include the wording of Japanese colonization, or I forgot the exact wording, but heartful apology, and also should mention about aggression. Those wording are also put in the Murayama statement. And then more people, about 50% of the people think that Prime Minister Abe should include, while 17% or 30% of people should not think Abe should not or do not need to. So I think the sentiment of ordinary Japanese people about apology is that Japanese leaders have apologized many times, and it is maybe sufficient. But it doesn't mean that it is time for Japan to forget. It doesn't mean that the public think that it is time for Japan to forget about future past and ignore about past. It's a different thing. So people support for Prime Minister to make a statement which mention about heartfelt apology or aggression, that kind of wording. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, just one small point. I think on collective self-defense, that I believe is something of a moving target in terms of people's perceptions, because the U.S.-Japan guidelines won't be coming out until when the Prime Minister comes, and the debate that will ensue over both that and the legislation that will implement that will be ongoing over the next few months. So I think it'll be interesting to watch and see how and whether public perceptions change on that particular issue. Other questions? Abigail.
Hi, Abigail Friedman with the Wisteria Group. Thank you so much. Really instructive. Good work went into this. My question is, after looking at all of this survey, what strikes me is that American attitudes towards Japan are pretty positive and pretty much where we would want them to be. Positive on trade, positive on the security relationship, positive in terms of public perceptions of Japanese. So I'm a little more worried about Japanese perceptions of Americans. Not very hardworking, not too trustworthy. sort of this maybe begrudging, these are the people we have to do business with. But so my question is really for Ambassador Schaefer, having been ambassador to Japan. What would be your recommendations for how to improve Japanese perceptions of Americans?
Abigail. That's a tough one. I think we have to not take Japan for granted. And I think we have to approach Japan more as an equal and get away from this old model that we know best. I don't think we have that attitude when we talk to the British. I don't think we have that attitude when we talk to the Germans. We certainly don't have that attitude when we talk to the Australians. If you try that with the Australians, you'll get thrown out the door. And so I think we have to stop that kind of aspect of thinking that a heavy hand in Japan will improve our chances of success. I think we have to be forthright. We have to say what we're going to do, why we think it's in our interest, and why we think it's in the interest in Japan. We worked very hard when I was there bringing a nuclear carrier to Japan. That a lot of people in this country said that will never happen. A lot of people in Japan said that will never happen because of the attitude as a result of the bomb, which you still see in this survey. But I thought the most dramatic thing that changed things was when Prime Minister Koizumi said the USS George Washington, which was a nuclear aircraft carrier, and because we went to an all-nuclear fleet at that point in time, Prime Minister Koizumi said, this aircraft carrier is coming to Japan for the defense of Japan. It is in our interest, it is in our security interest for that carrier to be here. And when that happened, and we did a lot of work, and both governments did a lot of work on trying to sensitize each side to what the other's position was, and I think it bore fruit. But when he said that, it changed the dynamics of the argument. It was not the United States has the right to do this and therefore we're going to. It was a collaborative effort, but he took ownership of the issue. And when he did that, it changed everything. And when the carrier actually got there, there were a few hundred demonstrators. When conventional carriers in the past had brought 20, 30,000 people to the docks when they got there. That's a huge difference. It was better. And when you see something happen in North Korea now, and the George Washington is in the Sea of Japan, I think it gives the Japanese people some comfort. And I think that's the way we ought to treat things in the future.
I think it's also important to recognize, but correct me if I'm wrong, Bruce, that these are personality traits that were negative, whereas the trust between Japan and the U.S. is pretty high. And I would imagine, I haven't seen the polling, but I would imagine as compared to other countries, we're probably better trusted than just about anyone else.
And we should also bear in mind that it doesn't necessarily reflect reality. The latest OECD figures show that Americans actually work more hours per year than the Japanese do. That the Japanese, when I first moved to Japan, all Japanese worked on Saturdays. That's not the case. Part of the change in Japan was to get rid of that kind of intense work life that left no opportunity for consumption, which we, of course, wanted the Japanese to do more of. I do think that, but these stereotypes linger, basically. I thought the ambassador's point that, you know, when you try to disassemble, why do the Japanese see us as aggressive? You know, I had thought about it, well, maybe they think, you know, we have this cowboy image in the world, et cetera. But I think he's probably right, that it may have to do more with the sense that the Americans were, for 20 years, have been pushing us to do X, Y, and Z, and that translates to the average person as, well, they're pretty aggressive people. Now, we're going to continue to be aggressive on issues that are in our national self-interest. There's no doubt about that. So I don't necessarily see that as a totally negative thing either. But I think the ambassador's right that there are consequences to the gaiatsu, and this may be one of them.
Other questions?
Samar Chatterjee Save Foundation. Since a lot of questions have been asked about honesty and so on, I won't go into that. I think it's been addressed. My question is, has America apologized, and this may be for Mr. Arita, has apologized for dropping of those atom bombs. And is that an issue in Japan, and will that create, if it did, if America did apologize for it, will it create a better trust or consider Americans more honest?
You ask me a very tough question. I think that it is natural for many Japanese people think that a dropping decision to drop nuclear bomb to Hiroshima Nagasaki was wrong, and while U.S. think that it was inevitable. So this, you know, it is natural that there's a difference. I think that for the first time, U.S. ambassador, the American ambassador based in Tokyo, I think Mr. Ruth, Ambassador Ruth, went to Hiroshima and attended the ceremony on August 6th, the Memorial Day of the new Hiroshima. And it was high reported in a very favorable way. And Japanese people feel very, very Japanese pleased to see that U.S. ambassador was in Hiroshima and at that event. And also there is a discussion that for president in the future, president, whether discussion hope that someday American president will visit Hiroshima. Not necessarily, but it doesn't mean that Japanese people want to demand some clear apology. But as a symbol of reconciliation, it is good things to happen. While maybe it is good for a Japanese prime minister to visit Pearl Harbor in the future and show the act of reconciliation. So I think that apology, some people make much of apology, but I think more important thing is to reconcile, reconciliation. And of course, apology is one element of reconciliation, but paying too much attention about to how much extent you apologize, I'm not so sure that it is constructive for the real reconciliation, if you have them.
Yeah, in fact, next year, Japan will be the host for the G7, and I believe there are only three cities in contention to host that. One of the cities is Hiroshima, so if that happens, the president will be there. Other questions? Right here. Gentleman here.
Henry Hetker, researcher at NARA. This year, rather late last year, we heard reports that there wasn't sufficient quality control in the production of airbags at Takata. I wonder, there was other companies like American companies, GM, Ford, where they've made mistakes as well. And then try to cover up what they did. But, well, quality control is essential to product safety. Is there a way to ensure and provide that quality control exists in any company, especially where the public is endangered to some extent from what they produce?
Any product safety experts here?
I think your point is well taken. I think the underlying assumption is everybody's got to be responsible for what they do, and they have to be transparent to as great a degree as they can. There are many overlapping regulations on both Japan and the United States that are designed to keep things like the airbag situation from happening or like the GM situation, the ignition problem, from happening, but they don't always succeed. And I think what you have to have is the ability to get redress in either place for the actions you've taken. And I think we largely are able to do that. But it is a process, and sometimes it works better than others.
And your question, it seems to me, presages what is the next phase in Japanese-American economic integration if we get TPP.
Yeah.
TTIP, which is the negotiation with Europe, actually is an attempt to begin to develop common standards across the Atlantic. It's terribly ambitious. It may not work. We may encounter the limitations of any kind of integration exercise once we start to get into this process. But it does seem to me if the transatlantic exercise does begin to develop not only common regulations, but common procedures for actually developing future regulations, that the logical next step in TPP, or at least certainly between Japan and the United States, would be to begin to adapt. And that may be 20 years down the road. But I do think that what you are getting at is the next phase of globalization. And whether that's politically doable at home in either country, whether it's technically doable is a challenge. We're still trying to figure out.
Yeah, and I that's exactly right. But I think that the free trade agreements now that we're negotiating are much more sophisticated in that regard than they have been in the past. Tariffs are not the hard thing anymore. It's what do you have behind the tariff that may inhibit trade. And we both sides, and it's not confined to the United States or Japan, everybody tries to put their thumb on the scale in some way with the regulatory environment that they create on their side to keep the other guys' products out of their country. But I do think that we're moving in the right direction on that, and I think that you're seeing a trade environment that spreads prosperity. And the best example that I know of is Canada, the United States, Mexico with NAFTA. What it has done for both for all three economies is just incredible, and I think that that's the way we ought to go in the future.
And it does seem to me that one of the opportunities going forward for Japan and the United States is we are both increasingly dependent on foodstuffs that come out of China and pharmaceutical products, at least raw materials that come out of China. We have a mutual self-interest in the safety of those products. We and the Europeans have the same challenge, and one of the things the Europeans and Americans are talking about is none of us inspect the factories and the production facilities in China as much as we should, but if we would trust each other to inspect one and then we wouldn't have to inspect it, we could inspect twice as many of these facilities. It seems to me the Japanese and the Americans could conceivably do the same kinds of things going forward.
Other questions?
I think they were
over here.
Yeah, hello. My name is Gregory Gums. I'm an independent writer. In one of the surveys, it was pointed out that there's a difference between basically a Protestant Anglo-Saxon American's view of Japan and their trust in Japan and minorities' view and trust of Japan. It somewhat surprised me, to be honest with you. Because, for example, if you take African-Americans, right? African-Americans originally, early on in the 20th century, right? Looked towards Japan, right? They had a high view of Japan, especially Japan's view of a coming power, et cetera, and being people that were seeing as not relevant or can't develop yourself. And also because of the role Japan played during World War I in trying to push for the Equality Amendment, right? To say that, there's not going to be kind of white countries and then the rest, I come from the Caribbean and the rest don't count. I mean, look, the Caribbean doesn't count. I do understand that to a certain extent. But this is an issue. And the question is, obviously, with the demographic makeover of America, right, this becomes a major problem for Japan. If it cannot gain a greater, to a certain extent, although it's still a majority, it cannot gain a greater certain acceptance with that coming group. So what is Japan doing there? how do you see some ways of doing something about this? That's the first question. The second question is, the ambassador, you said that the relationships between Japan and the United States, it has been quite one-dimensional in the sense that United States, has been very, Japan has been quite dependent on the United States for its defense. But the issue is, how much would the United States really want, ultimately, Japan to become much more independent of the United States in going forward and doing its own defense, especially with the background of the coming power up, obviously, of China, which can this can create a great problem because of the fact that there's still a lot of hurt feelings in that region because there's this sense that Japan simply has not, unlike to a certain extent Germany, really, really apologized for what it did and the horrific things it did in Shanghai, et cetera, et cetera. So thank you.
Yeah, give me the first question on the non-white support of Japan.
Right.
I frankly was surprised at that. Yes. I must say, I just didn't think in terms of that. And I think I'm going to need to think about that a little bit more before I can come up with a recommendation. But on the other part of it, should the United States fear a more independent Japan? And the answer is no. But I don't draw the same conclusion to that I think that you're. Question implies. I think a Japan that comes to the that thinks of itself as a independent country that is trying to persuade others to achieve what is in the best interest of Japan is a Japan that will be working hand in glove with the United States. I don't think those are exclusive. The United Kingdom is a pretty independent country. I don't think that the UK thinks that it has to do everything that the United States does, and they don't. But over time, we've had no closer ally that has performed in more places with us than the UK. I think what I'm trying to say is, if you look at what I believe are Japan's long-term interests and what the United States' long-term interests are in Northeast Asia and the rest of the world, I think they're very compatible. And I don't think we have to have a senior-junior partner in the alliance. I think two equal partners will come to the same conclusions for the same reasons. It's in our mutual interest. And there's always a debate as to whether it should be a three-corner relationship with Japan, China, and the United States. Is it a triangle relationship in which two are always angling against one, or whether it should be a seesaw relationship? I think it works better for the United States and Japan when it's a seesaw. We're on one side of the seesaw, and China is on the other. And when that happens, I think it's easier to bring everything in balance. If it's a trilateral triangle, I think something's always out of balance. And we have to be very, very careful, I think, that we don't allow others to drive a wedge between the United States and Japan, because I think that would be injurious to us, and I think it would be injurious in the long run to Japan.
We're almost out of time, so why don't we collect a couple of questions, and then we'll give each of our speakers a chance to answer those if they choose, or simply provide some summary comments. So why don't we go here and there, the three.
Well, my name is Sasakawa Harris, retired from State Department. I just wanted to make a comment about this so-called hardworking Japanese and the seemingly slovenly. Well, I go back a little ways. I think I'm probably older than most of you here. I was in Japan in 43 And when I entered Keio University, we had to go on military marches and running. And they said, Uehara, can you make it? I said, what do you mean, can I make it? Well, you're half Caucasian. Well, I said, well, so what? Ah, but you see, they're not as tough as we are. That's where the attitude, the basic fundamental attitude, still persists. I was quite surprised that, and well, I did survive. I did as much as well as any of the other Japanese students. So the attitude changed after that, how they looked at me. That is a story from 1943. I was then 18 years old, 19 years old. The other one is about the holidays. We now brag about we work harder than the Japanese. Well, you know, there is a story to that. Maybe all of you know about it, but it's not been mentioned here. We complained to the Japanese that's a non-tariff barrier. And will you please change it? So the Japanese were persuaded by the U.S. government to put in, quote, more holidays so that you Japanese don't work as hard. And one of them, Uminohi, the day for celebrating the sea, that's the one I can remember. So this is a two-way deal. We now say that we work harder than the Japanese or work a day more. Well, that's partly because we put the pressure on the Japanese in the 80s and 90s. To rectify the non-tariff barrier, and therefore the Japanese were persuaded to take on more holidays. It's not a question, it's a clarification to all of you here. Thank you very much for listening.
The others?
Okay. I'm Mark Tokola from the Korea Economic Institute. I wanted to follow up on Ambassador Schieffer's comparison of the triangle versus the seesaw. You know, given Japan's strong distrust of China, as we saw in the polling, its perception of China as being a threat perhaps, what does Japan want for from the U.S.-Chinese relationship? If the U.S.-Chinese relations took a sharp upturn and improved, would Japan see that as being to their disadvantage?
And over here.
Thank you, James. Independent reporter. It's interesting that the other gentleman also follow up with the ambassador's comment on the triangle relations. But there's another triangle relations there. South Korea, Japan, U.S. So that's within a family. But we all know that, as one expert pointed out, I don't see how you operate with an ally the relation between South Korea and Japan, you know, at a certain point in their headache over history issues. And do you see any possible future that the two side between Japan and South Korea, that they're going to crack at the ally there, especially when you talk about the grand U.S. strategy rebalance to Asia? Thank you very much.
Okay, why don't we go in reverse order from how we began, and Akita-san, if you'd like to answer any of those questions or simply provide some summary comments.
As for a hardworking question, I think this way. I still remember that when I was a kid, my father went to work every Saturday, and sometime even on Sunday. So I think that stereotype of Japanese image of Japanese public is that Japanese people is very, very, very hardworking, and that is one of the area we can be proud most. So, Paul, when you ask Japanese people whether U.S. is hardworking or not, criteria is too high. So it is Paul is asking this question to the wrong people, I think. So if you I don't think that American people is not hardworking in a global standard, but in comparison to the Japanese stereotype image, Japanese think that we are more hardworking. That is an answer. And about the U.S.-Japan alliance, I think that there is two models. One is U.S.-UK model, share all intelligence information and share strategy and always, most of the time, act together, even in the war in Iraq. But another model is U.S. maybe, it's not the alliance, but U.S.-French model. Maybe France is close partner of the U.S., but also they want to maintain a free hand. They have an independent nuclear strategy and so on. And so there's a spectrum to which Japan can approach in the future. I think that this model, UK, US, this model is very, you know, maybe Japan cannot copy this, but I think that the direction is supposed to be toward this direction when we look at the Asian security situation. And about the US-Japan-Korean triangular cooperation, I think after all, whether to how much extent we can share the threat perception or a strategic purpose, goal, is the main variable about this relationship. And I wonder if, to how much extent Japanese and Koreans' perception about the rise of China or China's military expansion is stay on the same, you know, domain or same or similar. Because I remember that there is a lot of discussion about the deployment of new missile defense system by U.S. to Korea, South Korea. But there's, China is opposing to that, and I'm wondering if South Korea will, government eventually will accept its deployment. I think South Korea will, but because South Korea is located, is a part of a continent, while Japan is separated by sea from China. So that makes it more difficult, I think. Well, that is a challenge for more closer cooperation in long term, I think. Thank you.
Ambassador?
I'll do it quickly. Hardworking. Doesn't everybody think the other guy doesn't work as hard as I do? If you look at the baseball, though, I'm in the baseball business. I'll give you a little insight into this question. American infields at a ballpark, at a major league ballpark, will have grass in them, okay? In Japan, they'll all be dirt. You know why that is? Because the Japanese players take so much infield, hitting the ball to the shortstop, practicing, that if you had grass in an infield at a Japanese park, it would have holes in it where all of the balls are hit. So they took the grass out. Now, I'll leave that to you as to who's the most hardworking baseball player in the world. Does the United States really want Japan to be independent, or if we had good relationship with China? I'm going to tell you a real prejudice I have. I don't think we can have good relations with China unless we have a strong alliance with Japan. I'm talking about that as an American. I think Japan's chances of having good relations with Japan are determined largely by the relationship that they have with the United States. It's in our interest to act together. And when we act together, I think we have a moderating influence on China and its foreign policy. Finally, on the Korea-Japan, interesting thought. Bruce is the authority on numbers here, but I think Americans are surprised at the animosity that exists between South Koreans and Japanese. They frankly don't understand it. Why should this be? But if you say that it'll never be better, I would go back with the history of NATO. And when NATO was formed, there was an internal argument as to whether Germany should be a part of NATO. The Netherlands were violently opposed to Germany being part of NATO for, I would guess, obvious reasons. That's overcome. And now Germany is a vital part of NATO, and I think everybody agrees, all the NATO members that think that's a positive thing. I think we can all look forward to the day when South Korea and Japan sit down together as friends who trust each other, the way they each trust the United States. I think the world would be a safer place if that were the occasion.
Satu?
Yeah, there wasn't anything specific, absolutely. But let me just sort of end on two comments, given what we worked with SPF USA on, which is, you know, these impacts and interactions of Japan and the U.S. Across the country. Two things. One is I was struck by Bruce's public opinion. One thing that didn't come out to me very strongly is that for all of these quibbles about hardworking or trustworthy or all these, first, the general trend line of the attitudes towards the U.S. and Japan in 2015 compared to 20 or 30 years ago is just light years different and more positive. So these strike me as very minor quibbles about who works harder, et cetera, which in a kind of globalized production supply chain economy, I think work smarter is far more important than work harder. How do you manage the supply chain? Where do you fit into it, and where do you have efficiencies? So that's one comment on this whole spectrum of issues. The second is, in the public opinion polling, it kept striking me that for the differences, particularly on views of where we would rank China as a problem, et cetera, there don't seem to be any strong drivers to change the U.S.-Japan relationship. That it seems to me on both sides there's a sort of comfort level while people tinker around the edges. There's no huge chasms on either side about these issues. So that's what I wanted to say on the public opinion and the polling. On the larger context of foreign policy and security, I mean, I'll leave it to the ambassador, but I guess one thing I would say in the work we've done on mapping how Asia matters across America is, as I want to repeat, for many states and districts, Japan used to be 90% of everything when it came to Asia, because Japan was that big of an economy, it was that big of an ally, it was that big of a source of our commercial, tourist, and other relations. But that situation has changed. There are now more players in Asia, and their interactions and impacts on the U.S. are now jostling with Japan's impacts and interactions in the U.S. And in looking forward, it seems to me what we have to think about to reinvigorate or further invigorate the U.S.-Japan relationship is, in this changed context, how do you build on the underlying strengths of the U.S.-Japan relationship? And what programs, what initiatives, what activities do we need to think about to take advantage of what I think is a fairly stabilized and largely positive public opinion and material facts on the ground. So that's, I would add that.
Two things on the U.S.-China-Japan triangle. There does seem to be a potential there while Americans overwhelmingly believe they want to become closer to Japan because of the rise of China, that doesn't mean that they also don't want a closer economic relationship with China. Whereas the Japanese, if forced to choose a closer economic relationship with the United States. So if a problem arises here, I think it's more going to be in the minds of the Japanese than in the Americans about this, and isn't there an inherent contradiction here somewhere? But I think Japanese should remember that Americans have very little trust of China, and they have a very high level of concern, our other polls have shown, very high level of concern among Americans about our trade deficit with China, with the fact that jobs are moving to China, and that the fact that the Chinese all hold a lot of American debt. So I think that will sober any embrace of China by the American people, not necessarily the elites, because the elites look at this differently. Our surveys show that American elites are much more worried about China's military rise and not its economic rise. So that's an interesting contradiction. On South Korea, I agree with the ambassador. I think most Americans are unaware of the tensions for the most part and can't understand them. This survey that you have in front of you, we did ask people about the comfort women issue between Korea and Japan, and over half of Americans had never heard of the issue. So I do think that it's not that prominent in people's views in terms of what's going on in Asia. We're much more aware of the North Korean missile problem or the territorial disputes between Japan and China.
Terrific. Well, I really want to thank all our speakers for an excellent job and a rich discussion. Before we give them our applause, just one quick announcement. We are running a little bit behind time. We've got a buffet lunch in back, but I'm told that if all of you can let the speakers cut to the front of the line, especially Admiral Blair, who has to eat quickly and speak next, we'd appreciate it. But please join me in thanking all our speakers today. Thank you very much. We are now moving to our keynote address, and our speaker today is Admiral Dennis Blair. He is our chairman and CEO at Sasakawa USA and has been at Sasakawa now for almost a year and has, over the course of that year, has dramatically increased the activities and staff and all the things that Sasakawa USA has been doing. And so has a few thoughts on some of the things we've been discussing today, so I'd like to turn things over to Admiral Blair.
Well, thanks very much to all of you who are spending your morning with us. I think it was a tremendous couple of presentations, and even those of us who have been around these issues for a long time have picked up new insights, new ideas. And it's also good to be here at an event that symbolizes the arrival of spring in Washington with the Cherry Blossom Festivals. So I'd like to make a few comments based on what we've heard this morning. We heard from Bruce Stokes about the high degree of respect and trust. And let's see, what do you say, Sora? Should we swap it out? Okay, is this one any better?
No.
I'm told to give it time.
Oh, maybe it's working.
Have we pulled a fuse on the entire sound system?
No, it's not.
Not that one, huh?
Oh, this one's working.
When you're involved in a naval accident and there's a choice between equipment and operator error, it's generally operator error. So Bruce Stokes gave us an idea of the high degree of respect and trust between the citizens of Japan and the United States. Satou Lemay told us about the deep financial, business, trade, travel ties between the country, over $1 billion spent every year by Japanese tourists in five different American states, 39,000 employees of Japanese companies in Illinois, California exporting over $20 billion to Japan. And then this all takes place here at the Cherry Blossom Festival, which highlights the cultural ties between the two countries dating back more than a century. So the ties between the world's two most prosperous democracies are positive, complex, and of long standing. There are even associations in natural events, like the arrival of spring here in Washington. For years, the tree that marked the end of winter here was the shad bush, and its blooming coincided with the arrival of the shad, which was a fish that spent most of its life in the ocean, then in huge numbers ran up the great rivers of the east coast of the United States, including the Potomac, to spawn. And it was the shad that often provided the first fresh meat of the year to both the Native Americans and to new settlers after the winter had made the game scarce. Now the shad are running again in recent years, now that the rivers have been cleaned up, and we'll be seeing shadberries soon in this town. But now it's the cherry tree that seems to mark the arrival of spring for many of us. And instead of the shad bringing fresh meat to hungry settlers, the tourists bring fresh income to hungry local merchants. So traditions change, traditions stay the same, and somehow the interaction between Japan and the United States weaves into native customs. Now, the individual findings of the poll results that you heard this morning are fascinating. We discussed many of them with our tremendous panelists, as we did some of these facts about what Japanese commerce means to the United States. And this overall relationship, as we said several times, is strong, positive, and deep. It's also of long standing. It was about 100 years ago that these cherry trees were given to the United States as an act of friendship from Japan. And the U.S.-Japan relationship has generally been positive on both sides during all this time, with several notable exceptions. In the United States, there was the period of anti-Japanese sentiment in the 1920s, leading to the immigration law of 1924 that restricted Japanese immigration, that imposed many restraints and prohibitions on Japanese who were already in this country. And during the war, the United States interned Japanese American citizens in camps without any due process or recourse. On the other side, Japan's military regime in the 1930s saw the United States as the chief obstacle to its ambitions, its expansion in Asia, and eventually attacked the United States in 1941 in an attempt to drive the United States out of East Asia. However, following that war, beginning 70 years ago now, a strong U.S.-Japan alliance formed that has continued and even strengthened, I would say, to this day. One thing that has always been remarkable to me is how close this relationship has been despite the enormous difference in our national characters. In fact, I think it would be difficult to find two peoples of major countries that are more different than Americans and Japanese. And there was a very interesting small book on the subject that was first published before World War II and then updated after the war. And the book is entitled We Japanese. It was commissioned by the managing director of the Fujiya Hotel in Hakone to try to explain to Western American visitors the true nature of Japan, to put in perspective the things that they would see around them. And there's a wonderful chapter in the book called Topsy-Turvydom that begins with these words. It is often remarked that Japanese do things in ways directly opposite to those of a foreigner. To the Japanese, foreign ways appear equally unaccountable. Now, some of the examples that this book gave were serious cultural differences that showed up in many cases in language differences. This book pointed out at that time that there were no words in the Japanese language which exactly expressed the same meaning as the terse English yes and no. And then there were humorous examples. A Westerner was said to stir his tea, quote, in the same way the hands of a watch move, whereas the Japanese do it in the reverse way, even though they live in the same northern hemisphere. Now, when I read through these observations, discussed them with some of those in our office who are either grew up in Japan or have lived there, what I found was there were some of them they recognized where they came from. Others they said, oh, no, that's not true anymore. And I think this combination of the legacy of the past thinking, the layers of new thinking which have come as we've had greater contact with each other are constantly forming and reforming in the U.S. Japan relationship. And if you step back and look hard, I think you see more progress than you see moving back. But nonetheless, I think at heart, Americans are open, informal, and direct, and there's a strain of the Japanese character that is private, observes the rules of behavior, and is often very indirect. So what is the strong basis of this? What is the basis of this strong relationship that has endured for generations, since it's certainly not based on cultural affinity as it is with, say, the United Kingdom, which we've had several references to today? Now, as the Cherry Blossom Festival reminds us every year, there's certainly strong cultural interest between the United States and Japan. Popular American culture fascinates some Japanese, music, clothes, and so on. Japanese culture, both traditional and contemporary, catches the attention of many Americans. Woodblock prints, food, manga, anime. These attractions, however, are more the attraction of the exotic, the different, between two countries and cultures rather than the familiar, the similar. The one cultural area that is common between the United States and Japan is, of course, baseball, as Ambassador Schieffer referred. Same rules, after all, 9 men on a team, 9 innings in a game, 3 outs in an inning, 4 balls in a walk, 3 strikes and a strikeout. However, on closer inspection, I would say the differences between how the game is played on the two sides of the Pacific are quite as striking as the similarities. In the United States, building a team around the qualities of individual players, Japanese training and molding of individuals to fit into precisely defined positions and role playing, U.S. fans heckling of individual players on the other team from the bleachers in very personal and direct fashion, Japanese chants, songs, and flags waving in the stands, U.S. brushbacks and bench-clearing brawls, Japanese team's stoic discipline in the face of adversity. Same game, different approaches. So although the cultural attractions between the United States and Japan are many and they're strong, I don't think they can account for the strong ties between our two countries. And neither can the explanation be found in the influence of Japanese ethnic groups in the United States, as is true for other nationalities, famously from the Irish through the Jews. Japanese Americans are, in fact, the smallest ethnic group from among the major American countries. According to the 2010 census, citizens of Chinese heritage were the largest single group of ethnic Americans from major Asian countries, followed by Filipino Americans, Indian Americans, Vietnamese Americans, Korean Americans, and then Japanese Americans. And Japanese Americans are among the least politically active of the ethnic groups in this country, with the possible exception of Hawaiian politics, where they play a very strong role. By the way, going the other direction, Americans are only the 5th largest group of foreigners who live in Japan, according to the latest statistics. So what is it that has kept this relationship, this alliance together all these years, 70 of which have been an alliance that we have referred to? I think I would come back to the central role of shared values. Shared values, but different interpretations. As the examples I gave earlier demonstrated, these shared values are not easily discerned on the surface, and they are not across the board, but nonetheless, they have brought our countries together over the decades. Over the decades since Japan opened to the outside world in the Meiji era, since the United States became a powerful Asia country in the 1890s. And one shared value is the common belief in the importance of technological progress, along with well-developed technological prowess. Alongside their veneration of the past and their wish to preserve it, Japanese also believe in the value and importance of newer and better devices. They have an inherent progressive problem-solving approach. In the past, much of Japanese technological progress was imitation, importing the best technology from foreign countries. That certainly was the early Meiji approach. However, if some of the basic technology was imported, the Japanese often reworked, improved, and perfected it far beyond the achievements of its originators. The Japanese automobile industry famously learned to build better, less expensive cars than those from the United States, and Detroit had to go back to school to learn the lessons from the Japanese continuous improvement processes. Japanese railroad trains were originally imported from abroad, but today Japan sells high-speed train technology back into countries that had developed railroads much earlier. And in Japan, many areas have gone far beyond importing and perfecting to discovering and inventing. Casio is given credit for the electronic calculator in 1957. Many Japanese companies were selling them by the 70s. Seiko, the first quartz wristwatch in 1969. Sony, for many years, was a powerhouse of inventiveness, from the CD to the digital camera to the Walkman. And most important of all, of course, Japan invented the automatic electric rice cooker. We just used ours last weekend. And in this century, Japanese scholars have won Nobel Prizes in chemistry and physics for the mathematics of subatomic particles, the discovery of fundamental processes of photosynthesis, and the discovery of the science that led to the LED, the liquid emitting diode. And these are certainly characteristics that are shared with the way that America approaches technology and technological progress. Now, another powerful uniting force, which we've talked about some in this conference, has been the shared value of common threats from other countries. And during the Cold War, the United States and Japan certainly were united by the shared threat from the Soviet Union. But again, with a difference, because so too, of course, were the countries of Western Europe and the United States. But on the two sides of the Eurasian continent, the forms of the alliance to deter the threat from the Soviet Union developed quite differently. In Europe, the key component of the NATO treaty is Article 5, and it reads, "The parties agree that an armed attack against one or more of them in Europe or North America shall be considered an attack against them all. They agree that each of them will assist the party or parties so attacked by taking action as it deemed necessary, including the use of armed force, to restore and maintain the security of the North Atlantic area." Now, the U.S.-Japan Alliance Treaty also has an Article 5, and it reads as follows. "Each party recognizes that an armed attack against either party in the territories under the administration of Japan would be dangerous to its own peace and safety, and declares that it would act to meet the common danger in accordance with its constitutional provisions and processes." In other words, as we've heard from Ambassador Schieffer, an attack on Japan would cause the United States to meet the common danger, but there is no reciprocal obligation for Japan to respond to an attack on the United States. And the next article of the treaty states that Japan will provide bases for American forward deployed forces in the treaty. So the security treaty with Japan is more limited, more transactional, and less balanced than was the NATO treaty. However, despite this imbalance, the U.S.-Japan treaty has a depth and a strength that has actually made the transition from the Cold War better, I would argue, than the NATO alliance. So where do we go? I believe that it is the foundational belief in representative democratic government that is truly the most common, most powerful common value between the United States and Japan. Now, democracy has historically longer roots in the United States than in Japan, where it did not gain influence and support until the 1920s, and then was completely derailed by the military nationalistic regimes of the 1930s. However, following World War II, the United States imposed a democratic form of government on Japan that country proved to be very ready for, and which has proved to be durable and resilient. But if my remarks this afternoon have made any point, it is that similar concepts in Japan and the United States can have far different appearances, and democratic values are no exception. Since 1955, a single political party has held power in Japan, except for one brief and recent period. Politics often seem hereditary in Japan. The current prime minister is the grandson of another, and Japanese political family dynasties go far beyond the Clintons and the Bushes, about which Americans are so recently concerned. However, the elements of representative democratic government are still present and functioning in Japan and in the United States. Free and fair elections, individual rights, an independent judiciary, a vibrant and contentious press, an honest civil service that provides government services competently, political parties that react to popular opinion and aspirations. And Japan, perhaps more than the United States, values shared sacrifice, voluntary, not coerced, commitment to work for the greater good, an ethic without which democracy cannot flourish. So over the years, as the United States has been involved in Asia at many different stages, from wars in Korea and Vietnam through long phases of peace, with great political changes in Asia in countries such as the Republic of Korea, China, Indonesia, the United States has continued to feel both a strategic confluence of interest and a confluence of values with Japan. And Japan, for its part, has not only relied on the United States for defense support, but has shared the preference for democratic representative forms of government, a strong private sector, and for working most closely with a country that shares those values. So what of the future? What is most exciting to those of us who work at Sasakawa USA is that the U.S.-Japan relationship appears on the verge of what could be one of its most vibrant and positive stages in its history. For the past 20 years, the relationship has been fundamentally strong, but in many ways, moving sideways. Japan's economy has been stalled. Its role in international affairs has actually diminished. The United States has tried many different approaches to the security environment that followed the end of the Cold War, some of which have succeeded, some of which have not. We went through a major recession of our own making, from which we are only now beginning to emerge. But now things are changing. Japan is taking vigorous action to reignite its economy. There are mixed opinions about whether the actions of the first 2 years of Prime Minister Abe will produce the desired results, but there is no doubt that Japan's leaders will keep actively pushing new approaches to seek to break out of the past doldrums. The United States is emerging from its recession, and the foundation for future growth seems solid. Japan has committed itself to a new national security policy, which Prime Minister Abe calls proactive contribution to peace. And Japan is moving out with diplomatic, economic, and military initiatives to play a much stronger role in the world. It is taking early steps to put more balance into that treaty relationship, that unequal treaty relationship with the United States. And in the United States, the upcoming 2016 presidential election promises to include, for the first time in many years, a strong and varied discussion of national security issues. What are the threats? What are the opportunities? What allies can we count on? And I have no doubt that out of this situation will emerge a U.S.-Japan relationship that is even stronger than in the past, that will serve as the foundation for policies that benefit not only both our countries, but also East Asia and other regions of the world. In the recent past, much, I would say too much, of the security dialogue between the United States and Japan has been about our relationship with each other, issues having to do with the basing of U.S. forces in Japan or narrow bilateral economic interests. I believe now that we have a chance to move on to big issues that are not only important to our two countries, but can make a difference in the East Asia region and further. Prime Minister Abe will be visiting the United States later this month, the first official visit by a Japanese prime minister in about a decade, and will be addressing a joint session of Congress during his stop here in Washington. And I hope that the impetus from his visit will overcome the last few obstacles in the way of U.S.-Japan agreement on the terms of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, the TPP, that TPP that will set the framework for international economic relations for 11 more countries very quickly, and many more, hopefully including China, in the longer term. It will establish the rules for an international economic system that favors the very best practices in areas like the environment, labor practices, state-owned enterprises, many others. And also in connection with the Prime Minister's visit, the two countries will undoubtedly announce a new set of bilateral defense guidelines, the first since 1997. And the primary changes from past agreements will be in the role of Japan. While Japan is not about to become an aggressive wielder of its advanced military force, it will modernize the U.S.-Japan defense concepts in many important ways to meet the demands, the challenges of the 21st century. From the Japanese point of view, Japan will have a greater ability to support its interests in a more equal partnership with allies like the United States. And for the United States, there will be a commitment from Japan to work together in new situations that threaten our common interests. In a world in which few of our traditional allies seem interested in events outside their borders, and most are decreasing their military expenditures, I think it's good to have a partner that is thinking how to do more and is actually increasing the resources to do it with. And with these two important achievements nailed down, which I hope they will be shortly, it's time for the United States and Japan to get to work in other areas. We can cooperate to support the early democratic transformations in many countries of the world, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, for example. We can work to support that progress in countries that are headed in the right direction, Indonesia, or need to be put back on the right path, Thailand. We can even work on China eventually becoming a more democratic country. In the near term, we can cooperate on supporting China's entry into the world economic system in efforts to bring it into dealing with regional challenges in the Middle East, with North Korea, for example. We can deter Chinese newfound power from being misused for territorial gain on a unilateral basis. and we can challenge China to move in a democratic direction, a direction that will be necessary to unleash its full potential. The United States and Japan can cooperate in the area of energy, dealing with climate change. There's a full range of important objectives important to both China, or excuse me, to both Japan and the United States, and many of them to China, that can be achieved by a shared vision, closer cooperation across a full range of economic, diplomatic, and other spheres. So I think this Cherry Blossom 2015 is a marvelous chance to look back at the U.S.-Japan relationship and to value the many cultural ties between the countries developed over the years. And it's also a tremendous opportunity to think about the future of the alliance and to commit ourselves to new possibilities, new promises. Thank you very much, and why don't we take a few minutes to see if there are any last thoughts or questions, and we also have the panelists earlier who can answer them. But those are the only things that stand between you and the next thing on your schedule, so. In that case, I wish you all a wonderful Cherry Blossom Festival, a great spring, and we'll see you next time. Thank you.